Hello everyone, thank you for being here on Friday afternoon. I'm so grateful. So the topic for today's presentation is a diverse band-aware dynamic spectrum access network architecture. It's a long name for ubiquitous rural connectivity. So we'll go into the details of d-DSA network architecture, but before that, let me introduce myself and then let me go through all the research that I have done in my PhD, and then we'll go into the d-DSA network architecture. So as he already mentioned, this is how my academic profile looks so far. So I'm here currently as a research assistant professor in wireless at Virginia Tech, where you all belong, in the Bradley Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering. Okay, so my research, I have primarily worked on two broad areas, which is d-DSA network, which we are going to cover today. And then the other one is disaster response network, which I'll discuss in the next slide. But beside this, I have collaborated with a PhD student on a biological network called gene regulatory network. And GRNs, or gene regulatory network, are basically the network of genes at the DNA segments and how they regulate each other. How they activate a certain gene, how they deactivate a certain gene. So we study the graph properties of such GRN network, and the objective is to create a robust and energy efficient communication and computer networks by studying some of the graph properties of such biological networks, which are known to be very robust against random physics. And we go beyond that and we try to improve the robustness of such GRNs by improving its graph properties by sort of changing some of the links here and there to make it robust against targeted failures as well. And then I have also collaborated with a postdoc on participatory sensing application. And here the idea was to propose a reputation-aware risk tolerance model for preserving the trustworthiness of data in participatory sensing application. And here we utilized behavioral theoretic approaches like prospect theory, decision utility theory, and so on. So disaster response networks. Here I worked on four different subdomains. The first one is network architecture. This was my undergraduate work. So here we propose this four-tier network architecture to create a temporary communication network in the aftermath of a disaster to provide communication between survivors and responders. This was the bachelor's work, like I said. Then we studied the resource planning or the resource allocation in post-disaster scenario. And here the objective was to allocate the limited resource pool, network resource pool. That could be communication towers, that could be data mills equipped with access points, such that you serve all the shelter points and then offload the data from the shelter points to the MCS, which is the control station, in the least possible time. That was the whole objective. Then we also proposed this routing protocol where we explicitly wanted to exploit the natural gathering of survivors, which is the shelter point. So if you notice, in disaster response networks, you cannot assume the existence of conventional network. So in that case, you have to create a temporary communication network, which could be based on smartphones or remaining network tools like some access points, some undamaged cellular towers, using those remaining infrastructure and the smartphones which are capable of creating this P2P network or D2D, device-to-device network. Using those kind of networks, we wanted to create a temporary communication network. So now these devices are extremely sensitive to energy because there is no presence of power sources. So that's why we proposed this cluster-based topological routing protocol, where we exploited these clustering of survivors and tried to improve the energy efficiency. And we saw that we were able to increase the energy efficiency by twofold compared to the existing traditional approaches. And finally, we used that GRN approach to improve the robustness and energy efficiency of disaster response network, the topology itself. And that was my recent work, and we are currently working on the journal version. These are some of the tools that we developed. We developed this post-disaster resource allocation tool, and then we also have developed this customized hardware which we deployed in this a place called Sundarban in India, and then we saw that our architecture does pretty well compared to the unplanned architecture or compared to the existing architectures. And this one is basically the Android application that we developed for our experiments. Like I said, the goal here is to create an end-to-end disaster response prototype that promptly deploys a robust, energy efficient, and cost-compliant temporary communication network. And that's why we studied all the possible aspects to create that disaster response system. The topology control, the network resource planning, the architecture, the routing protocol, everything. Okay, so now let us talk about the real presentation for today. So rural connectivity, I don't need to really motivate you why rural connectivity is really important. As you can see, connectivity improves your life, quality of life, it improves health and well-being, it improves social equity, educational opportunities, and so on. However, as of today, almost 50% of world population are still unconnected. As you can see, in the developing countries like India and Peru, it's even more than 80%, which is pathetic. So the key reason here is the high investment cost, because of which the ICT, the traditional telecom people, they do not want to invest in such architecture and deploy cellular or standard technologies to such rural areas. And this creates a huge digital divide between rural and urban communities. And this is where we want to address. These are some of the notable efforts that have been proposed in the past. So one is darknet, which was proposed in MIT Media Lab. As if you see here, the approach is very simple. They deploy Wi-Fi access point on the public vehicles. So whenever these vehicles go to the villages, they collect the data, whatever they had to, and whenever they visit the city, they offload the data to the nearest access point. And then from there, it goes to the internet, and it happens the same backward towards the village. Here, it has been successfully deployed in India, Bangladesh, and some African countries as well. So it's actually commercially viable here. And the key point here I want to mention is that it doesn't require a lot of infrastructure, because you basically deploy Wi-Fi access point, that's it, right? And then we have some kiosk at each unit, which is another infrastructure, but it's extremely minimal compared to the cellular infrastructure if you really want to do that. But at the same time, this is based on intermittent connectivity. You cannot always have the connectivity, because here the buses, whenever they come in range with the villages, they do have connectivity, but whenever they leave the villages, they do not have any connectivity. There are some efforts from the industry side. So Google proposed this project called Loon, which is a network of stratospheric balloons. And here the idea is that any LTE-enabled devices can connect to those balloons. And then similarly, Facebook Internet.org, they try to utilize the local cell infrastructure if there is any. And satellites and UAVs to create our network. Yes.
So how is the coverage?
The balloon?
Yeah, the balloon.
It's pretty large. I mean, it's still in progress. It's still not really deployed at large scale, but these are being proposed, and Google is really considering it. So, but they expect them to be very large, because it's at the high altitude. So, okay. So, irrespective of what approach we go for, they either use short-range standard technologies like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, or they use long-range cellular technologies, which is 4G, LTE, and upcoming 5G. So if you look at the standard technologies, they are really not suitable for ubiquitous connectivity to rural areas, because the area is pretty large. Cellular technology is very promising, but at the same time, like I said, it incurs a huge investment cost, and because of that, the telecom providers are not willing to pursue or basically deploy these infrastructure in rural areas. And then this paper, Hassan from UC Berkeley, they actually saw that they don't want to really do that, mainly because of its expensive spectrum licenses, even after government subsidies. So this is another key point. And there are additional challenges. So one, we are aware of being here at Wireless at Virginia Tech, that that the current static spectrum access policy is creating a spectrum sparsity. But the other one that I want to add here is that the way spectrums are being used as of now, they do not have the flexibility of addressing different messages heterogeneously. So for instance, if you always try to use LT band for irrespective of what message you get, either it's a high definition video, either it's a text message, you are basically extremely sensitive to this spectrum being overprovided. For instance, if you want to send a text message, which is 2 kilobytes over LT band, it's already a spectrum being overused, right? Overprovisioned. You could do that with a spectrum which provides you way low bandwidth than the LT band. So these are some of the problems that we want to address. But before we go into the d-DSA, we also want to discuss the DSA in general. So what is the conventional dynamic spectrum access that has been proposed so far? See, if we look at the crux of this paradigm, it's a very simple idea. So any secondary user, any wireless device, can use any licensed spectrum band as long as they have idle channels available or unoccupied channel available, and then the condition is that you do not interfere with the primary user. So if you do, it's illegal basically. So that's the only condition. And this gives us an option to break away from the static spectrum access policy. And this was proposed by FCC in early 2000, I believe. And this was mainly done for spectrum efficiency. So we have this class of bands, which is usually the DSM or LT. They are overused, right? There are so many providers. And then you have this unlicensed band. There are lots of devices. But at the same time, you have this big chunk of band in TV, which is not really utilized because, I mean, how many hours a day we watch TV? Right? We watch maybe a couple of hours in the evening, maybe on the weekend, but rest of the time, the band is always available. So we wanted to solve this problem, so there are certain bands which are underutilized, and there are certain bands which are overutilized. So why don't we give the secondary users utilize any available channel in any given band? And then, you can improve the spectrum efficiency in this case, if you allow to do that. And that was the whole concept. So as you can see, this is really promising because even in big cities like DC and Chicago, more than 60% of the spectrum bands are mostly available. And if you go to the rural areas, which we are dealing with, 80% of the TV band is always 24 hours a day available. So far, the literature, they have focused on spectrum efficiency. That was the main problem that they were dealing with. And to enable the spectrum efficiency or to make DSA a reality, you have to solve all these problems. The four key functionalities: a spectrum sensor. So you need to keep sensing the available channels, right? So that was the first problem that researchers dealt with. They proposed three different spectrum sensing approaches, including energy detection or cyclostationary approaches, those kind of things. And then once you have sensed the available channels, which spectrum do you want to use? Which channel do you want to use? So that was the other main focus. And spectrum sharing becomes important because there could be two secondary wireless devices who want to use that unlicensed channel on a secondary basis. So how do you manage, how do you synchronize between these different secondary users? And finally, whenever a primary user shows up, how do you leave that channel? Because you cannot really operate on that channel anymore. So that was the spectrum handler or spectrum mobility. And to make that all happen, you need cloud integration. So these were basically the research that has been done so far. We are going beyond that and we want to see how these technologies can help rural connectivity. So we won't say that we are the first. There are a few more. So like most of these works, they have proposed TV band to provide rural connectivity. In fact, Microsoft had already deployed and had already made some deployments. Surab Abhis Hassan and Surapati Dev proposed utilizing GSM LT band. And Hesar, he from Washington, he proposed utilizing CBRS or radar band. But the issue here is that they are restricted to an individual band. And most of the time, they do not even specify what TAN they are using. They simply make an assumption that there is a chunk of TAN from a minimum frequency to a maximum frequency. And this band is partitioned into an orthogonal non-overlapping channel. Now, each channel has a certain range and has a certain bandwidth, and they are dealing with certain bit rates, certain bands, which is basically the problem here. First, bands are not the same. If you are talking about TV band compared to LT band compared to CBS band, they are very different in their characteristics, which we discuss in the next slide too. But again, they largely ignore the message traffic heterogeneity. They consider this packet, which is fiber network byte or so. And then they suffer from the spectrum being under provision or over provision because they do not consider the aspect of band into their network modeling or into their approaches. And these are some of the works that I'm putting out here. As you can see here, they either assume an orthogonal channel or they assume the TV band, which is basically a pre-specified fixed band. Similarly, for the electromagnetic characteristics, as you can see, they assume this bandwidth, they assume a certain packet size and the range. Some more. So, like, these are some of the recent work in this domain. So that's why we propose this new paradigm called diverse band-aware DSA. So here the idea is very simple, that we extend DSA to exclusively take into consideration this diverse set of bands, which could be TV band, which could also be unlicensed ISM band. What's wrong in that? Which could be upcoming millimeter waves, right? So as long as you have these different bands, try to exploit all those different bands and see how they can improve the quality of service requirements of heterogeneous messages. That was the whole motivation for this work. And this becomes really promising in the sense that different bands have different electromagnetic characteristics, right? Because if you go with a TV band, irrespective of what antenna gain you consider, you always get a better rate, right? If you look at the FCC regulations, different bands have different bandwidth, and it usually increases with high frequency band. Transmit power is different for different bands. So these things make it a very interesting problem, that how do you schedule different bands to address the requirements of different heterogeneous messages. So when I say heterogeneous messages, it could be based on its message sizes. It could be few kilobytes, it could be hundreds of megabytes, it could be few gigabytes. It could also be in terms of time criticality. So it may need, you know, few minutes of delivery delay, or it could be few hours in case of sensor data. So these are different metrics, or these are different quality of service requirements that you may be dealing with because of the heterogeneous messages or heterogeneous QS requirements. And then you have these different types of bands. So now you see there is a sort of optimization here. So that's what we are dealing with. Okay. So now in the ruler ages, how are we going to utilize this d-DSA paradigm? So we propose this architecture, which is highly inspired from the darknet. In fact, when I wrote this paper, I wanted to call it darknet plus plus. Okay? So you see, we have similar concepts, that we have these villages, we have this agricultural field, we have a connectivity hub, which is nothing but a city in that scenario, and that we have a similar path. They also have a very single path, but it could be a many different paths. But the additions here are that we have to take into consideration primary users, that is base stations, and then we'll have two different interfaces, right? We'll have d-DSA paradigm, or d-DSA, we call it d-DSA node, who has the capability of d-DSA paradigm. So basically here we have these four different components: sensor block, which could be a drop field, which could be a village. Then we have drop boxes, which could be a kiosk in case of darknet, or it could basically be a laptop, which could talk to different sensors, smartphones, video cameras in the sensor block on a standard wireless network. We do not want all the sensors to be d-DSA there. So they could be the conventional sensor. So basically the Dropbox is the one who is sort of acting as a bridge between the conventional network and the d-DSA network. The d-DSA network consists of data links, which would have a d-DSA radio, and then it has a connectivity hub who will also have a d-DSA radio and the Dropbox. So these three components will have d-DSA radio. Okay? And then these data mills are nothing but basically the roadside assistance units, or it could be the public bus in case of that. Okay, so it's a similar argument that we'll have minimal network infrastructure cost. So that's a very good question. So right now, I am assuming that we have taken care of physical and material. Okay, and in fact, I and Solmaz are working on that. So how to make that a reality? And in fact, when I will talk about the protocol that I designed, that problem will be solved. So I will discuss that in more detail. But we are looking into that problem. Like how an existing transceiver can really work with different bands. Any more questions? Okay, so now based on this data mill type, so like I said, data mill could be a fixed roadside assistance unit, it could be a lamppost equipped with a d-DSA radio, or it could be a moving public transport vehicle, right? So based on this mobility pattern of these different data mills, the form d-DSA network topology could be very different. It could be a static d-DSA topology, and it really makes the problem very simple. Not very simple, but it makes the problem different than a mobile d-DSA network. So here you can assume the global knowledge that what spectrum and what channel within that spectrum you can really utilize at a given time, at a given location. Once you have this knowledge, you can propose a centralized global solution, because now you are a genie in your case, right? You have this, you are the god, right? You know everything about the network. So that's the problem. So here we particularly studied determining energy efficient routing protocol under hard and soft TTL deadlines. So that was the focus there. Then the other one is the time varying DDSA network. Now this could also be a few times. One, where you can predict to a certain extent the mobility of data. So if you only consider public transport vehicles, which have fixed routes, right, and they have fixed time tables at certain work units. And in that scenario, you can predict to a very large extent with acceptable accuracy. But then if you consider private vehicles, taxis and cars, then you cannot really predict. Right? So we are going to discuss sufficiently predictable DDSA network for today, but I have worked on all those different network topologies. So here the key challenge is how do we model such time evolving DDSA network, and then since it's a time evolving DDSA network and we have this different concept of the heterogeneous messages and the distinct electromagnetic activity of various bands, and we also have to protect the primary user from interference, so these things make the routing a very critical problem. Again, I wanted to highlight that we are dealing with this part of the architecture. Right? We assume the existing architecture inside the sensor block. The sensors communicate with the Dropbox on existing traditional network interfaces like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. Okay, so now the network modeling. So we model network as a sequence of graph snapshots. So basically, the network is moving over time. So we sort of flip pictures at each time. So for example, this is a small, for example, five different nodes. And then let's say there are two different times. And then this is timestamp from 0 to 15. So we are basically taking pictures at time 0, time 1, time 2, and time 3. So now how much granularity you need is a different question, but we assume this network model and we give a very good approximation for it, which we are going to discuss in a while. And this is how our whole graph would look like. This is basically a union of graph at each snapshot. And graph at each snapshot is basically the node and the edges over each communication, over each spectrum, right? All possible communication opportunities at each time, on each. And then for the messages, since we are dealing with heterogeneous messages, But again, these messages could be of arbitrary size, right? So we cannot really have infinite number of messages of size. So what we did, we created this n discrete bins, and then we allocate or we put all different messages to each distinct bin. So for example, let's say your message size is from 1 MB to 100 MB. So we created this 100 bin. So message size is corresponding to 1. If it is more than 1, we split it as 1 and put it in bin 1. If it is message 2, then we put it in bin 2, and so on. Irrespective of what prompts they are, right? It could be text, it could be video, it could be code. So that's what a message type means. So if there is a message type C, it basically means a message type with message size C into Q. And Q is basically the interval between these different things. So it's 1 MB, 2 MB, 3 MB, 4 MB. Basically, Q is 1 MB, right? Okay, so now since it's a time varying graph, we have to define a link function that tells me that if node, let's say Vi and Vj are in communication range over that band, then this link existence would be 1. So this basically tells me that the communication link over band S at time t between node I and node j is 1. So now if you want to transmit a message, right, then the link has to be 1 for the entire duration, for the entire message transmission duration, right? That's why this function is true, that if the message starts getting delivered at time A, at time PA, then it has to be 1 to have that message successfully delivered to that node J. If the link existence is 1 from the initial time to the completion time. So that's what it is. Okay, so once we have this network modeling completed, now we propose the d-DSA, we call it d-DSA R routing protocol, which stands for diverse band aware DSA aware routing protocol. Since there was two aware, so I got it up and d-DSA, d-DSA R. Okay, so here, unlike the traditional network protocols or routing protocols, we also have to determine the optimal spectrum band at each node. And since we are dealing with these different types of messages, so now the routes has to be corresponding to different messages too. So these are the two new aspects to the routing protocol if you deal with such DBSN network. So it works in two discrete rounds. So let me explain the two discrete rounds. The first one is bootstrap round. So bootstrap round is basically it's sort of a training round in a machine learning problem. So what happens? So among the connectivity hubs that we consider, one acts as a network manager. So what it does, it collects the mobility patterns of each data node, let's say at the end of the day. Okay? And then it collects all these mobility patterns. So now based on those mobility patterns, it creates a space-time band graph, which we are going to discuss. So this consists the sort of global knowledge about the network. Okay, this STP. So let's take my word for it for now. And then now since you have this network, now you compute the least delay computation paths, which is basically the route, right? So now once you have computed this route, you share the routing table to each bus so that they would follow the rules laid out in that routing table on the next day, which is the operator. Okay? So all the hard work is being done in the bootstrap by the network manager. Yes. Yeah, so this is something that the network administrator has to develop. So for instance, if you are getting the network performance that you assume or that you consider without really redoing the bootstrap round again and again, you can go away with one bootstrap round and multiple operator round, right? But for instance, if your bus route changes completely, right? So now the thing that you did in the bootstrap round is not really going to reflect in the operator round. So in that case, you may have to rerun suppose that. So it depends. It depends upon the network architecture based on what you want. In the best case, you just need one bootstrap round and then you can keep doing operator round. In the worst case, you have to do the bootstrap round after every at each operator round. So the network manager does the bootstrap round and the other people does the operator round. It's just lagging behind by one time key.
Nodes have to?
So is it clear or not? Okay, so we want to minimize the delay. Yeah? So, irrespective of what message size you are dealing with, irrespective of what message types you are dealing with, we are trying to improve the delay for each message from the source to the destination. That's the performance metric that we consider. Because we are dealing with intermittent network. Right? So it becomes a very relevant performance metric. Because here delay is basically the most important issue.
But we would like to extend it to energy efficiency and other network throughput maybe. Or maybe different types of heterogeneous quality of service requirements. Why not? Huh? In fact, we were discussing with this that different applications would need different quality of service requirements. Like one would need, let's say high bandwidth requirement, like video streaming, or one would need, let's say, least latency requirement, like safety critical message. So now, how do you deal with different QoS requirements in the same d-DSA network architecture? But right now it's very simple. We are assuming a uniform latency requirement for each message. Here, the parameters are the band and the messages. So messages could be heterogeneous. They could have different TTL requirements. That's possible. But QoS requirement for all the packets are the same.
Yes.
They all have memory. Yeah, and they store the message if the link is not not up. Right now, yes, but we actually address this problem in the Jarno version that we recently submitted. So in this we consider infinite memory, but then we address this problem when you have this finite memory. That's what happened, and we actually saw a very interesting.
Yeah, so since we are computing a routing protocol, so the message will only route from week to call. So if we want them to stay at the node, they have to stay. So this is the routing protocol. Yeah.
So what are the number of nodes we have to
Yeah, so we didn't prove it here, but this is a very simple proof that, right? So if a certain network, so let's say there is a network with 5 nodes, and then if you notice, this is basically a variation of sorted path, right? We are trying to find path between different source and destination node pair, which minimizes the delay. If you delay, basically the edge weight, you are basically trying to find the sorted path. So if you have more nodes, there is a higher chance of getting sorted path, right? Does it make sense? Because you could have alternate route, or you can go with them. Yeah, so we'll talk about that.
Okay. So now the STV graph.
Okay. So STV graph is a layered graph. So what we do, if you notice, so we had 4 nodes in the previous example. So what we do is we create multiple replicas of that node corresponding to that. So this is there's 2 different bands, we were at one. And then corresponding to time. So like there are 4, remember there are 4 times. So that's what a layer graph looks like. And now the question is, what should be the granularity? it could be movie center, or it could be hours, right? So what we did for that, we say the least massive size that is in our network is C equal to 1, right? Or basically the minimum size, the message with minimum message size, right? Which is C equal to 1, the message size is that. Now you have these different bands. So now you know the band which will give you the best or the highest feature, right? So the minimum message transmission time that is possible in such a network is basically C by that width, right? So now even if you create a layer graph with a granularity of time less than the minimum message transmission time, you cannot really transfer any relevant message or any actual message, right? Because that's the least transmission time where only you can transfer the message. So that's why we consider the granularity this state as the minimum message transmission time, the transmission time. Makes sense, right? If we do that, we are not leaving out any potential or any possibility of sending a message. Okay. And now if there, so like for example here, this is a small example right here. So now let's say you have these message transmission types 1 and 2, and the size is, for example, 3 is there. So you basically have two messages of sizes 10 and 20, right? So now if you take a message transmission time of which is, so this is time 1, right? Which is basically the message time, right? And this is your video, which is 6 and 20. So if I do this, it is 0.5 seconds. So this is my the time interval in the layer graph. So now if I take a time interval less than 0.5 seconds, which is let's say 0.2 seconds, right? So now if I'm dealing with such a scenario where I only have two message times, 10 MB and 20 MB, and I only have two bands which give me the bitrate of 620 MBPS. Even if I create a layered graph with 0.2 seconds, I'm not serving any purpose in terms of message transmission, right? Because 0.5 seconds is the minimum time, minimum transmission time, irrespective of what spectrum resource you use, irrespective of what kind of message you are dealing with. You need that amount of time to really transmit the message. So that's and then we wanted all other times to be multiple of this time. Why? Because it's easier to deal with the layer one. Because your layer is basically the scalar times time. Okay, so now now the nodes are clear. So I guess the nodes are clear. In fact, in the next slide I have, yeah. So this is what the nodes do. So if you have p+1 layers, then the node is b into p into s, right? Because you have b nodes and there are s copies in each layer, so b into s, and then you have this p layer, so b into s. It could be -1 somewhere because it just started, but basically the number of layers. Now if you look at the links, there could be two possible links. So one is the temporal link, which is the upper image. So temporal links basically tells me that you do not send the message to any other. You hold it there for that time. Okay. So like if I do not transfer the message to anybody from layer 0 to 1, then there exists a temporal link from layer 0 to 1. Okay. And the spatial links is basically the possibility of transmitting a message to a different node at a given place. So here this link basically tells me that node 0 at time 0 has the possibility to send a message to node 3, okay, at time 1 over band 1. So this one is band, this one is time, and this one is the node ID. And why is this possible? This is possible because the message size is so low, but the message has a transmission delay of 1. Okay. This is the minimum message size. And then the link existence between node 0 and node 3 was 1 for that time. Okay. So now if this link exists, it basically tells me that the link existence between node 0 and node 3 over Dan Hill was always on for three times from this layer to this layer. And then you can really transmit all the messages of size, not of size, of delay, or of transmission delay or transmission time for three times. So that's what this graph tells you. And in this way, you can basically create a whole network. Okay? As long as you know the MobiDB or you know the previous location or geographical location of each node at each time for that, or for that time, whatever time you know. Okay? So this is what we did. And this is only possible when you collect the mobility traces of all the vehicles for the entire time period at the network level. And it's not unrealistic because network manager could be a bus depot, you know, and then buses at the end of the day they come at the depot. So now he can have the network. Okay. Yes. So when we created this HTTP graph, we could consider in terms of polling. It's basically going through each time slot, which is from 0 to the next one, right? And then see the link existence, right? So if the link existence is still there between these two nodes at that time, then it's gone, right? If link existence was there in the previous time and it's still remaining, then you add both the links. The current link and also the previous time and this link. So, it goes on. Yeah, definitely. There would be multiple links. So, if this link exists, right, definitely this link will exist. This link will exist. Yeah, but definitely. Yeah, this will link. This will exist. In fact, I will show you one sample in the next,
I think, after a few slides. How the STB graph looks like. Oh, in fact, here, see?
So this is how it looks like. So, I mean, this is a very simple graph. This is, I'm trying to create the STB graph for this graph. And it just has two band, five node, and I only consider the message like one, just one. Right? So, that's why there is only link between the continuity node. And there is no link between the additional layers because for message type one, you do not need two layer node. So this is how complex it looks like.
Okay, but before this I was expecting something else. Okay, no, it's good.
So now if we're dealing with the STB graph and if you want to compute this minimum delay communication graph, what would be the complexity? It would be V into S into P whole cube, right? Because that is the number of nodes in that graph. And that's too complex. So we wanted to improve on the complexity of the running complexity of the algorithm. And for that, we explored two proportional STB graphs. And we were able to reduce the search time from that V cube into S cube into P cube to V cube into T. Okay?
So now once we used, let's say, whatever algorithm we proposed, to improve the complexity and we computed this LDC standard for this delay computation part.
Then this is basically your routing table, right? Because once you have the routes, now you know which node has to travel to which route on which band. And if it has to wait, it knows for how many times it has to wait because that's a temporal length. Right?
Okay, so this is property one
and this is a very simple property. So what I say that if there is a pair of nodes and if there are, let's say, S number of possible spectrum bands, then if you want to determine the least delay path, you always have to go with a band that gives you the least transmission delay. All that. If you take a second verse, you know, a second band, then that's not your optimal solution. If your optimal solution will consider the band which gives you the least transmission delay, which is fairly simple. We put it in the paper if you want to have a look, and it's proven by proof by contradiction, which is pretty intuitive. This one is a little more interesting. So let us look at this more now. So there are different layers in your SDK, right? So let us consider this one. So now you want to transmit a message from node Q to node B, right? So let's say this W is your optimal delay path. Okay? This part is your optimal delay path. So now you want to send the same message from the same node, let's say at a previous time, at time. So now what I say is that the delay that you enter is always either going to be the sum of temporal lengths, which is x, because the x is not defined, right? You can always go to time plus t, just follow the temporal lengths. So you either have to go through this path, or you have to find a better path, right? So that would be, and that's going to hold, right? Because if you find a worse path than the temporal path plus the optimal path here, then that's not going to give you an optimal path, right? And this reduces the complexity quite a bit, because now you do not have to look for all the possible T's and for all other different routes. You don't have to go through that route at all. You don't have to explore all the possible routes at all. You only find the best route, which is a better than that. So in fact, I can show you briefly the code here. You don't have to see the details, but so this code is based on dynamic programming. Okay. So now dynamic programming. So the first one is the initialization state. So in the initialization state, this is very simple. Here we initialize each. So this is the same node. So we say that if it's the conjugative layers between the same node, it has to be a temporal layer with transition time of 1 down, right? Now this is the spatial one. So this is where this band invariant property and delay invariant property comes into picture. So here I say that the delay that you incur between a pair of nodes, right, among all the possible bands with this one, you can directly assign it to the band which gives you the minimum delay. This is one. So here I already reduced the complexity by half. Now, here what I say, the path between node I and j, between t and t dash, is either the minimum, right? So I only consider this two. Either the minimum of the path that you found, which is this t is basically the other t plus, so in fact, there must be one there, right? So what I'm saying that if you have found the optimal path at this t, and if you are trying to find a path from one time previous to this thing, this either has to be this plus one, because you can reach there by this temporal length, or you find a better path, which is this. And then you keep iterating and iterating, which is this state. And this is path computation state. So you keep iterating, and when your S is equal to capital S, which is the number of bands, and when your I and j equal to capital N, which is the number of nodes, you find the best. Okay, and this is small t equal to capital.
Yes.
Yes.
In fact, this is proven, right? This is the extension of Floyd Marshall algorithm. We proved it in the paper, but yes. Yeah. Dynamic program has optimal structure, right? Yeah. Okay. So once we are done with the STB graph, we are done with the LDC path computation page, now we have the routing table. And we call it STB routing table, and it's slightly different from the traditional routing table. So if you notice here, we have this message type as one column, and then the destination node is similar to the traditional routing table. But now each cell has three values, right? One, store, which is the temporal length, and then forward, and then the band. In the transfer table, we don't have a store and we don't have a band. We just have forward. So that's the key difference here. Again,
we do everything in the bootstrap route, which is a time period before the actual operation, right? So now the mobility patterns between bootstrap route and operational route could be different, because these are public vehicles, they could be jammed, with accidents, there could be road construction, whatever, right? So in that case, we wanted to have some mechanism to fall back upon when you really do not find the path or the node or the band that you want to communicate on, right? So in that case, what we say, we went with a very simple approach. We say we just hold on to that and try to send it again at the next time, following the rules laid out in that problem state. We can definitely come up with a better approach, right? Like, for example, you can go with a band with a different band, you know, with a similar band. Or you can go with a different node, right? You can do K forward looking or something, K look ahead, for example, right? But for now, we just consider a very simple approach. We say, hold on to that. Done said. If you don't find the rule, if you don't find the node, the band, to send the data to, you don't send it anymore. Okay, so once we have the routing table done, so we wanted to validate our routing protocol. So for that, we used this data set called UMass DigitalNIC. It was a data set collected at UMass Amherst, and they contain 30 buses over an area of 400 square kilometers, but only 9 buses really had some data. Okay, so we threw away other, and in fact, out of 30 buses, only 20 buses were on board initially. So 10 buses were already gone, and the 11 buses had less than 50% of time instance. That was another problem. So we had to deal with the 9 buses, and it made some sense, because in the rural connectivity, you cannot really expect a lot of buses. And for the network traffic, for the message sizes, we consider very traditional, baseline values, as you can see. Network traffic, we consider bus to traffic with exponential at a time. Message sizes, we exclusively wanted to consider different message sizes. That's why we consider from 1 MB to 700 MB. And then for the traffic bar, we consider the maximum allowable traffic bar. We also did it with like 1 watt for everybody, but with a different experience. But we see very tangible difference between different bands. And for the other parameters, since it was a rural area, we consider the path loss factor of 2.5, and then threshold by the medium and so on. And this picture actually shows the bus route on different time periods, which is morning 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. and afternoon 2 to 5. And you can see this color is basically one bus. So you can see they don't really change the route. And these are due for a week. The end of the same showing for a day. But even over a week, the message, the bus mobility patterns were not same. So that was good. Okay, so now we needed to compare with the existing approaches. So when we deal with the intermittent network or delay tolerant network in general, these are some of the basic protocols that have been used. So epidemic, it has been shown that this is the best protocol. If you are not worried about energy, you're not worried about memory. So epidemic basically flooding, that you give the message to anybody and everybody who you need. That's what epidemic. The spray and wait tries to be more intelligent. So what they do is they operate in two phases. In the spray phase, so for instance, you have this L number of messages. So you send half the messages to the person you meet and keep half of them. And the second person you meet, you give half of the remaining. So let's say N is for 24. And you give 12 and 4. Now if you meet the second person, you give 6 and keep 7. If you meet third person, you give 3 and so at the end, if you are left with one message, then you do not give it to anybody. You give it to the destination node by yourself. So here we are trying to improve or minimize the number of copies in the network. That was basically the thing. Hot potato, you give it to one guy, the guy who you meet for the first time. It's a very simple protocol. And it's a forwarding protocol. So other two were forwarding-based protocol. This one is a forwarding protocol. So now they were proposed for traditional intermittent network, right? And since we're dealing with a diverse band of a DSA network, so we wanted to have some fair comparison. So what we did, we extended these protocols in order to enable them to use the benefits of having different bands. So this is the way we extended. We say, for instance, spectrum-aware epidemic routing. So what we say, that each node still follows the rules that was designed for the epidemic routing protocol. But instead of always operating on, let's say, Wi-Fi band, you can operate on a band that gives you the best. So we do not change the rules of the protocol. We only give them the power to harness different bands.
Okay.
And then we see, then these are some of the plots that we put down. So message delivery ratio. So this one is the d-DSA art. And you see we do pretty well as good as epidemic. So like I said, epidemic is extremely good because we do not consider finite memory and those kind of things. But an interesting part is that if our mobility is highly predictive, you know, that we know where the buses would be, then in that scenario we also do very well. So this one, the green one, which is invisible, you know, but this is the green one. And there are all different protocols. And the CBRS ISMK basically tells me that these bands only utilize one particular band. So for instance, the red dotted it uses LT band. LT band is supposed to do well because it has good range, it has good coverage, good bandwidth, so it does pretty well. In case of energy, we do extremely well, right? Because we do not flood the network. We give the data to the person who is laid out in that routing. So our is a forwarding the routing. So that's why we do extremely well compared to flooding the routing. So that's why this is going to reflect on the energy, which is this. So this one particular. So in the energy we do well because we do not make a lot of copies. In the delay we don't do really well because again we ask them to wait at the DDSA node if you don't find the route, right? But if you are very predictable, then in that case we also do pretty well, right? Because now we find the band and the next guy because it's an ideal scenario, it's a highly predictable scenario. So we basically find everything as per the rules laid out in the routing code. So we do pretty well there. So this is an area where we want to improve. And like I pose out some of the rules, we can pursue some of those directions. You know, we can go with the second best approach or second best band or second best relay node or key look ahead. But we haven't yet decided on what approach to follow. Or maybe we can go with, in fact we're discussing, we can go with the reinforcement learning approach. So we start with this architecture or this routing protocol, but as time passes, we can update the routing table based on some reinforcement learning approach. So we also saw scalability, like for different number of nodes, we still do pretty well, and the results are more or less in the similar fashion. So this is the conclusion. We propose this DDSA network architecture. We propose a new graph model called STD graph, and then the routing protocol and our experiments so that it do pretty well, other than the network delay, which we are going to hopefully address soon. So there are few ongoing works that I'm working on. So this is one of them. So here we wanted to consider more realistic parameters. So for instance, if we consider limited memory, if we consider potential MIMO capability, you know, so then this makes the problem even more interesting. And this is what we formulated. It's pretty easy, but we are working on that. We are not able to. So this one, as you see, this is a time varying formulation. So we formulated for the entire time right now. So then again, if you want to solve this problem, we really want to find out what bands are available ahead in time, how nodes are going to move ahead in time. So all these different knowledge we need to find the global solution, which we are going to do for the benchmarking purposes. But eventually we want to go towards the distributed approach as well. So this is where we are looking into. And this is what I'm currently looking at. So in fact, I'm trying to hire a graduate student hopefully very soon, so that we can implement our DDSA network architecture using some DSRP platform. And I think we are going to put on the flyer very soon. hopefully I'll have my sister here.
Not a PhD because I cannot support a PhD student at this point.
Okay. Eventually, we also want to take into consideration application specific traffic classes, which we discussed a little bit. And we also want to consider application specific QS requirement. So, how are we going to deal with these different parameters in addition to different bands and different messages? More focused on the application side. So, depending on what application you are dealing with, they could have different traffic, network traffic, and then they could have different QoS requirements. So how our d-DSA architecture is going to deal with all of this. I want to thank all my collaborators and students that I work with in my PhD. These are some of the references, and this is what my vision is. Okay. Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah.
In fact, we have now more control on our model.
Yeah.
We wanted to save on the cost. Because buses are already there. They already travel to villages for the problem that happens or the carriage that happens. So we don't have to do 12 buses. That's not our
plan.
UAVs could be an approach, but I don't know. UAVs have batteries, and then you have manual. But I mean, dealing with existing buses, buses are already there. We just learn the d-DSA radio and in fact, since starting, it's already there. It's commercially viable. It's being operated in different countries. So if we just improve on that, using the new d-DSA architecture, that would be very good. That was the one motivation. That we do not want to propose a new architecture. We are trying to improve the existing architecture. And then we can use what we
it would
give us a lot of benefit. And then we also don't have to depend on the buses. So that's another angle. So now we do not have to deal with what is the variable model and very talent. We don't have it. So that gives a lot of comfort.
Yeah,
because now we also have to decide on the band. So there could be a band switching. But the channel delay within the band should be the same. But you'll have this additional component of band if you're dealing with the delay band. In fact, I need to be clear, but we actually categorize the energy and the delay in terms of DSA network. Like how the notion of spectrum band is going to change the transmission, change the delay to the factor of the channel sensing delay and switching delay. And we saw that basically there is one extra channel. Other than that, because once you, again, we discussed multiple times, once you decide on the map, now it basically pick up the DBS. Right?
Yes,
right.
So, how are you thinking about
DBS? Yeah, because, look, those values are given to us. Like, for example, we started an interest. Right? We know the frequency, we know the DBS, we know the. For instance, the TV band, let's say we consider 600 megahertz. So, the material that the TV band can be frequency is 600 megahertz. You can compute it. Yeah. If you are dealing with CBR band, it's 3.5 megahertz. So, now, given that the frequency is 3.5 megahertz, you can compute it. they are already different. The formula remains the same.
I was more interested in how you model this cost of training, but that's not in the
Actually, it will be independent of that. It does change the rate, but it changes the rate for everyone. So we are not really trying to make more and more realistic with more realistic partner model. We are more interested into looking at different band characteristics. Because irrespective of which band you consider, the partner model is going to be your partner. So once we decide on the plan, so we can use all the existing technology and to develop the team. And once you have decided on the plan, now you can now for the channel selection, channel mobile, you can use the existing options on TV. So we are not really going into the channel selection. It's a very small extension, but it's a very effective extension. You have now this holistic idea of utilizing all the available spectrum resources instead of restricting the spectrum. That's what it's like. Okay, thank you.